Hello, everyone, and welcome to this episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. I am Wade Price, and I'm delighted to be joined once more by the great Chris Peach, or as he has come to be known from the new Drukhari Codex we've seen it revealed, Archon Piach, the cruel, well-met Archon Piach.
You remembered. Nice. I'm not great. I just great. I think that's what you meant to say. You got that wrong, but fine. No, I prefer Piach the Cruel. That's a good title. Archon. So how are you?
On the moniker of a Drukhari Archon for the purposes of today's podcast, I'm grand. Thank you. Powerful. Delighted that we've got however many miles of distance between us, because you're going to probably devolve into your crazy alter ego, as Archon ever wanted to do. Excellent. Well, we'll try to keep the voices as normal as possible for the benefit of anybody listening who's not familiar with our vocal range. This should be another episode of the podcast, hopefully conferring some of what Peachy knows in a responsible and knowledgeable fashion about collecting, building, painting Drukhari miniatures, because not only have you had your lovely army featured in the Crusade section of the new Drukhari Codex, you go ways back with the Drukhari painting, don't you?
Oh, yeah, very, very far back. It was quite early days, actually, to when I was in the army painting team. I had the pleasure of building, at the time, resin, because we didn't have plastics, all the witch stuff. So I was building a witch court army. So heavy metal were doing all the Black Heart and Court of Strife stuff. So Lilith Hesperex babies. And of course, the big man himself, Azrael Vex stuff. So they were doing all that, doing all the paint guides, and I got the chance to do a army. And I kind of themed it to witches. I made sure I had transports for every squad. And then had some Hellions as well and some Reavers. I think I painted Lilith Hesperex as well, but treated her as a succubus, because that was another leadership option at the time. But that was fun. I definitely remember having a good sit down with Jez as well, Jez Goodwin, because he was talking through how interchangeable all the sets are now. You can take the arms off the Hellions and you can put them on the witches. You can take the arms off the Reavers and put them on witches. You can take the arms off the Hellions and put them on the Reavers. I was like, this is great. So very interchangeable, and all the heads as well. So very interchangeable range, which was great fun to play with. And you kind of enjoyed some of the weird and wacky conversions I came up with. Didn't go too mad because it was quite a new release, so we don't want to go too down the rabbit hole when doing a new army. So, but yeah, that was fun. I enjoyed doing that.
You don't really need to when the fittings are designed to be that interchangeable. When every head pretty much across the range can go on any other body that you might want to fit it onto, you don't have to do anything too wacky, because you're going to find an awful lot of opportunities to make things that weren't immediately presented to you on the box art or the web store image.
And that absolutely
scratch your itches, because you do like that kind of creation, don't you? Like a
I mean, I you know me, I don't tend to follow all the color schemes that are laid down. I always go my own way, and I was kind of the key thing with the red grief, because so used to seeing like it's very rare that you see like quite bright red tones for Drukhari or Dark Eldar, as they were at the time. So it was usually some form of black or dark iron with like highlights, so it's almost like, you know, neon bits on the edges, very much like the Black Heart and Court of Strife. So yeah, going full sort of red armor, and it went up quite bright as well. It was definitely the old Ranger paint, so we had like Mechorite red in there and stuff, and Deneb stone, so the predecessors to things like Mephiston red and Pallid Witch flesh and Rakar flesh. But that was fun, having to play around with different color schemes. In the end, I think I settled on orange markings as well on the vehicles, so you had like blue, bright blue hair, red vehicles with like a black undersuit for the troops, and then like these orange markings scattered across like the Hellions and the Raiders and Ravagers. That was, yeah, some interesting play with color for sure.
I remember you also worked with your partner, the studio team, on that Raiders of Kamara, was it? The Dark Eldar as was painting guidebook. Excellent. It's in his hand. Reference available. And the Lords of the Iron Thorn Cabal that you'd painted a collection for.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, that, it was. That, I think that might have been our second paint guide as well, because the first one was Space Wolves, and then we were just given free rein of like, hey, we need at least one of the main factions covered. So the Court of Strife was picked out in there, which was kind of handy for doing things like the Black Heart as well. And then me and Steve got a bit of free rein. He went down the route of the Cabal of the Flayed Skull, and he made them look very pretty. And I got the Lords of Iron Thorn, or Lords of the Iron Thorn. I was experimenting with colours, and the word iron to me says, yeah, I probably should do some metallic armor maybe on them. And after a little bit of going back and forth with writers and artists and stuff, we settled on having like a bit of a purpley hue in the armor, because really the Eldari are what caused Slaanesh to be brought into the galaxy. So having that kind of element of like, well, yeah, Slaanesh is based off these people, so it wouldn't be weird to make him look a little bit sort of, you know, tinted towards that kind of vibe. So yeah, using lots of purple washes in the recesses. A really cool thing as well, I'd never done it up to this point, so all credit to Steve. I was like playing around with like undersuits, and he says, why don't you try Incubi Darkness and shade it with like Norn Oil and maybe highlight it with a grey? Because he was thinking about what he was going to do for his, and we both had a bit of a play on my colour scheme and his colour scheme, and it was brilliant. It's like it suddenly became like alien leather, and then later on down the line from the Age of Sigma, it became my like sort of Mortal Realms magical beast leather. But it's such a nice sort of different way of, I was so used to doing black with grey highlights. So getting a chance to add like a different hue to the leather. And I really enjoyed that army, actually, the Lords of Ironthorn. There was a lot of like messing around with like conversions again, doing different things here and there. But I did like different, not quite different unit markings, but there was certain heads that had horns and certain heads that had spikes on the top. So I kind of put ones with more spikes on the top into one squad, ones with more like horns coming out onto another squad, or more like spiky ridges coming out the side, actually. And then just did like red markings going up the helms, which looked quite nice and striking. And then after that, I did a unit of Trueborn. They were a thing at the time, and they are now as well, because you obviously... I've seen the bits of the codex, so you get the favoured retinues. You can have Cabalite Trueborn. So I based it on the rules that were laid down then, so you can have multiples of the special weapons like shredders and stuff. And I know it's not a rule-based thing, it was more a visual thing, but I gave the... Saberite, that's the name for the unit commander, gave him like two Agonizer whips, just look really cool. I know he only has one, but it just looked great to have two whips, makes him look pretty intense. And I used all the Reaver helms for the helmets, so these like silver domed helmets with like red flashes on it and stuff like that. So yeah, a lot of playing around, a lot of having fun with kits and just doing some cool markings and stuff. So yeah, that was a good book. I enjoyed contributing to that. It was very, very much fun. A good thing. And I got to convert an Archon and they got some art. I was like, wow, someone's drawn a picture of the guy I made. This is great. So yeah.
That was a good time. I remember that. It's worth observing the near mythic Steve that you referenced, Steve Barron, a former army painter with you yourself, now a scenery designer as part of that scenery designing team, has painted a number of fine collections that have graced all sorts of codexes and battle times, including, as you say, that Cabal of the Flayed Skull collection. There's an interesting theme in the Cult of the Red Grief that you'd worked on and the Cabal of the Flayed Skull, lot of red in them, and when you put them together on the same table, they look like a unified Drukhari force, even though they're drawn from two sub-factions. And that kind of leans on what the heavy metal team have shown us with the Cabal of the Black Heart and the Witch Cult of Strife. Similar sorts of coloration. The skin's very much the same because they're from the same parts of Kamara, presumably, but the armor color's the same. The hair color is something that unifies them. So as well as the faces and bases mantra of things that draw attention, and certainly bases to help unify disparate elements of a miniature's range across a collection, that notion of using something like Incubi Darkness as the undersuit that would further unify stuff across that collection. You've picked up loads of tips from the great and the good ever since the launch of the Dark Eldar, by the sounds of it, haven't you?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've been lots of help from heavy metal painters. Steve, accomplished army painter, he wanted to go into heavy metal, but actually really enjoyed doing armies, so that was good having him as your wingman by his side, helping along the way. There's an interesting point as well with Drukhari and stuff. You can pick a witch cult, you can pick a cabal, and then a homunculus coven. But actually, like the box art stuff, you can tie it all together with the same color scheme to keep it as a running theme. That's not too odd. I've seen a lot of collections that look like that way, that have elements of each. But in the same vein, you can also go mad and do whatever you want. I mean, one of the things I always wanted to do was do a squad of Hellions, because they are kind of like Comorite street gangs, aren't they? So they're probably all just daub themselves in different kind of tones and colors. So there's always been the idea of like doing just like very individual looking Hellions that have their own sort of marking system, just, you know, for themselves, the individual, as opposed to as a unified unit. But yeah, so you can go from one end of like making it super unified, having like a color that runs through a collection like the Incubi Darkness leather, or just going full on I'm trying to remember, there's a lass that works in Warhammer World, and she's done some amazing stuff for Drukhari. I don't know if you've ever seen it in the cabinets.
It's Emma
Voltaire, yeah. So she's done a different raider, and there's a different squad that goes with it, and it's like you've got green ones with like white markings on it, you've got like white ones with like red markings on it. It's a beautiful collection, really nice. I always walk past the cabinets again, that's really cool. So that's a great way of like scratching lots of color itches, and it doesn't look odd because it's very an Archon will just grab different cabals together and go, right, let's go and do a real space raid and kill some stuff, feel younger for it.
Feel young again, yeah. We talked a little while ago about the Head Knights of Slaanesh and the Dark Angels. That was a kind of a podcast that followed up some of the battle ready videos that have been recently added to YouTube to let people know how to engage with some of the newer miniatures. Maybe there's an awful lot of Drukhari painting resource out there on YouTube already. So I wanted to talk to you maybe about if you were to start a new collection, or for the benefit of anyone who is going about setting up a new Drukhari collection, how would you go about choosing test models or choosing the sorts of models that featured in those battle ready videos, and what sort of principles and techniques and textures would people need to be expecting to paint if they're going to be painting Drukhari?
Yeah, it's a really good point, actually. And I remember when I did my first test model, I just did a witch. And the problem there is sometimes it's really hard to translate that to some of the larger things like the vehicles, as well as other unit types. It's fine if you want to pick out like the colours of a Kabbalite warrior and a witch cult warrior. But actually, if I was to do it again, start from scratch, I would pick a Reaver, or even a Reaver for the most part, and maybe a Venom. But I'd probably stick to the Reaver if it was just one model that you had and you wanted to try everything out. So what your vehicles will look like, what your crew will look like, what your warriors would look like. Because you've got a Reaver pilot who has the undersuit and has the armour. So all the things are there that you need to know. And like the little pipes for like the stims and drugs and stuff. Combat drugs. And then you have the vehicle itself, so the markings on that, how you'd go about doing that, picking them out, and what colors you'd use to, so that, you know, will it tie in nicely, would it be like and that's the thing actually that I always try and do, is make sure the vehicle's a little bit different from the crew. So the way I highlight maybe the reds on the vehicle will be different to how I do on the actual crew members, otherwise it just becomes a bit of a shapeless mass. One of the things I did actually with my vehicles was just did like chipping around the edges in metal. So it was like some ancient alien metallic that they make the vehicles out of. So that was a really good way. I used the same base coat, but just used metal to chip around the edges. But yeah, I would put my hill I'm prepared to die on, Wade, is to say a Reaver will tick all the boxes you need. Unless, of course, you need to like, how do I do a Kronos or how do I do a Talos? Then you might need to just pick one homunculus to do that.
Because across the range, the Kabbalite warriors, the Kabbalite aspect and the witch cult aspect, there's varying degrees of unhealthy looking Comorite flesh or skin and segmented armor. The Kabbalites tend to wear a bit more armor than the witches, who have a bit more exposed skin by and large. So if you've got a sense of how you're going to paint the skin of your Drukhari and the armor of your Drukhari, and how that undersuit will contrast with the armor, armor and undersuit together, you want to make sure you know how they're going to look. You get those on the Reaver. So yeah, the Reaver crewman should give you everything you'd need to know about your infantry models that you paint, and then the jet bike itself gives you a sense of those harder, flatter textures, getting to practice that edge highlighting with the flat of the brush rather than the point of the brush, which would be something that you could scale up and apply to Venoms and Raiders and anything else similarly.
Absolutely, yeah, perfect model, perfect.
When it comes to colours, I think that's a great point that you made about the metallics, the Lords of the Iron Thorn Cabal in particular, making their metals and forging and fashioning stuff. The idea of chipped exposed star metal on the prows of their vehicles, because as part of your work in the army painting team, separately, you would also have to have considered work for the Craft Worlds book and looking at Asuriani collections and making sure that type of Eldari is kept visually distinct from the Drukhari and the Harlequins, who also got a painting guide dedicated to themselves. Maybe one day we'll talk about that. So that idea of, it's not Wraithbone, it's not what the craft was used. They have a completely different industry and war gear and weaponry, just little touches like that throughout the collection, all of the collections. Exposed metal on your Witch Cult of Red Grief, lots of metal on the Lords of the Iron Thorn. You wouldn't expect to see quite so much metallic in any sort of Asuriani collection. Okay. To keep them visually distinct.
Yeah, I definitely remember having a conversation about what does that look like actually on Asuriani, you know, like Wraithbone, how would you do damage? So we end up finding like colors for that and like having a way of doing it, but for most vehicles we didn't touch on it. It was just like, it's just very well kept. They're all artists. When they get back to the craft world, they probably fix it straight away. So whereas the Cumorite stuff, it's like, yeah, it's part of the trophy, isn't it? All the scratches and dents on your vehicles, it tells a story of how many villages you've murdered and how many empires you've crushed. You know, it's like, oh, do you remember that dent? Yeah, that was that Space Marine commander who was like looking all cocky with his power sword. Yeah, he's in the arena now in bits. Oh yeah, he is. Yeah. So yeah, I can imagine they definitely have like heritage and story to every piece of dent and scratch upon their armor.
So having not settled upon your Reaver or your test model, are there any broad considerations for painting Drukhari? Are there any themes or sorts of colours that you think are most strongly associated with Drukhari?
Yeah, I think definitely dark brooding colours for the most part, either whether that's going to be the undersuit or the armour. And like saying, picking like Emma's from the store, even like the white colour felt dirty and dark and evil when you looked at like the raiders and the troops. So it's trying to get that kind of vibe, like the grim darkness and the, I guess the murdering nature of Drukhari into your color scheme. So you could probably pick any color. I'd even argue yellow. Take the Gangs of Kamara box set that had yellow Reavers on it. We'll probably touch on that in a bit, but yes, I certainly think pale skin is key. Really sort of like, it doesn't see much daylight, and they're kind of very vampiric in their nature, because they regenerate from the torment of others. So very pallid, almost alabaster skin is very reminiscent of Drukhari. And you want colours to emphasise that. So like witch cults, you know, probably something that looks like dried blood or reds. I mean, I've seen many tones of colours, but I always think in my head red works well, whether that's on the hair or the undersuit's red and then the armour's black. Always seems to be a nice sort of way to go. And then cabalites could be anything really. I mean, I've seen metallics, golds, brasses, bronzes, everything from black that's highlighted to red, black that's highlighted to purple. Usually, but you get that kind of, it's dark, it's brooding. You don't want like super, but I was going to say, you don't want super vibrant colours, but then the Hellion route, I might go down that route, make him almost, I don't know, cyberpunk-esque kind of tones, just really mad. But like, I guess like, look at like really extravagant motorcycles, like the really vibrant colours you get on. It's like, yeah, that marking on that's that Hellion, that marking on that's that Hellion. So yeah, it's I guess there's no whole bars really. I mean, in my head I have an idea of how I'd want to approach it, but actually I think you could do anything really that you wanted to.
There's still some kind of resonance with Slaanesh and the sense of excess going on, because none of them have just mousy brown hair or a lot of shocking extreme colours, and there is an element of that cyberpunk look or any sort of punk look that you want. The witches particularly, you see a lot of the exposed hair on those fighters, and they're attention seekers, so they're going to go in for things that will attract the attention, and it is an opportunity to cut loose and make sure they're inhuman. I guess that's another way of looking at it from a painting perspective. You might have a complete set of skin tones that you use for different sorts of humans and hair colours that would go with those sorts of humans, and doing something inhuman is an opportunity to push. It strikes me, having talked to you at length about Daughters of Cain from the different mortal realms and your darkling covens and dark elves of the world that was, as we've looked into more fantastical approaches in the mortal realms, and we've seen your Daughters of Cain with different skin colours, and maybe I'm just like not in the right places on the Drukhari scene, but I've not really seen too much of that.
But
whether it's painting it to themselves, or they've got toxins that they're trying to get themselves immune to and inured to, and they're dosing themselves up with weird stuff, it definitely feels like it's an opportunity to like allow yourself to push hair color, skin color, anything else like that you want.
Yeah. I mean, the way I did like the green tones on my Daughters of Cain for you know, those two like models from Morgoth's Blade Coven, you could quite easily see that as something on Drukhari. I mean, to be honest, yeah, any skin tone would work, but you've got to kind of give it that sense of a pallid nature to it, like really like drawn out, and it's not a healthy skin by any means. It's they're ancient, they're old, and they wither until they see agony in others, and then they kind of get a little bit more, I guess, flushed skin. It's like, oh yeah, that was good. Oh yeah, I feel a little more pink around my cheeks now I saw that person get beheaded in a horrific way. But yeah, absolutely experimenting with different, and that's, I guess, another thing is, if you do nail a color scheme, actually the skin tone might be the thing that makes all the difference to that as well. So white alabaster skin might not necessarily work with it, so like something that's got a bit more like purple hues or blue hues or almost darker tones to it. Take the Homunculus Cove and some of the skin, the flayed skin tones I've seen of them as well, like, almost like the box art ones where you've got like that pallid flesh, then the other, I think it's the back of the box where it's just red, it's just flayed. But that's cool, you know. Or they could be completely coated in war paint. I mean, I did like little bits of war paint on my Call to the Red Grief, like little bits of red eye makeup, very similar to how I did some of the stuff on one of the witch units for the world that was. So that's another thing, you can add a bit of colour in there as well, like with war paint and markings and stuff. They are very tribal. They are very, like you say, there are all these like things like evil warriors mixed with cyberpunk and tribal or combined together. It's quite a cool collection. This is weird as well. You just riffed off like, yeah, your Daughters of Cain, you got Darkling Covens, you got Drukhari. I remember I was never interested in Drukhari and Dark Eldar and Dark Elves for a long, long time. And all of a sudden, it's just like they've got such a cool aesthetic, so many cool models out there, so much interchangeability. Yeah, it's definitely become one of my favorite of collections. It's just dark, pointy-eared, long-lived elven folk.
Was it when you started riding a motorbike and you thought, oh, I need a reaver and to live forever? You could
become that. Yeah, I need blades, an agonizer whip. Yeah. Absolutely.
I know the agonizer whip is one of the many tips of the day and various community requests, or just having a look at all of the different painting resources that are already out on the Warhammer channel on YouTube. You've definitely got the Cabal of the Black Heart, which is the heavy metal color scheme that we see so much, which is also kind of applicable to the Witch Cult of Strife. Yeah. There's a Painting Venoms video, the Cult of the Red Grief Armor, which I think gives you a good selfie. And then the Cabal of the Flayed Skull Armor, which is that nice red Cabalite part. Yes. There's the Cabal of the Obsidian Rose, the Cabal of the Dying Sun, there's Battle Ready Cabalite Warriors, there's Drukhari Agonizer Whips, and there's How to Paint a Rack, and maybe other things I haven't found, which is plenty of
good stuff. Yeah, good collection. Yeah. I mean, from all those videos, you could look at all that resource and combine that, like the skin off that and the agonizer is now done there. Oh, I really like the way that the skin's done there actually for that unit and the skin there for that unit. I like that armor. I like that undersuit. So there's definitely, it's almost like a pick a mix of cool things that you can just use as a resource to change like armor cues or just between different units. And I know this is going to sound like really broad, but actually we've got so much painting resource out there on YouTube now. For the videos we do, if there's like, I really want to do blue armor for my Drukhari, then just look at like how we paint Crimson Fists, how we paint Ultramarines. Maybe take those colors and just look at how it's applied on a Drukhari, the method. So you've got the color here, but you've got the technique there, and just combine the two. So that's the thing that is always available. I know sometimes it has to be said, because a lot of folks I speak to don't just go, oh, I never really thought about doing that. Yeah, just watch the video on how to paint that serrated armor. But instead of using those colours, pick those colours from, oh yeah, should probably do that. So it's not always obvious to go down that avenue. So there's plenty of things, not just Drukhari videos, that you can use as a resource for colours. So many dark and dirty evil colours out there, Wade. You can
paint. Oh, I'm a big fan of painting things black and red, as you know. And by the end of this podcast, I'll probably be planning out a kill team of something or other. Inspired by your Cult of the Red Grief. I was looking, and you reminded me that there's a little distinction between the Witch Cult of the Red Grief force that you painted originally, that's got blue hair set against the red bodysuits and that, and your own personal collection, you've got pink hair, which tied into some of your Daughters of Cain collections and paint jobs I've seen elsewhere.
Yep, I mean, that second Call to the Red Grief was a personal army I started working on. It was definitely before and during the Raiders of Kamara paint guide that we did, because that's when Steve came along and mentioned about doing like incubi undersuits, which I then employed onto the Lords of the Iron Thorn as well, because it's beautiful. But yeah, it was just started off as like a bit of fun, just do a bit of converting. And initially, we were looking at actually putting that into the book as well. But actually, there's a lot of cool stuff in there. It was not really needed. We've already covered like things in the past. So I was like, yeah, that's fine. I wanted to build an army anyway to play games with. So there's a lot of converting there. But yes, the subtle changes. I think the red armor is very similar to how I did the original Call to the Red Grief. So like the tones of red to almost like orangey highlights on the edges. But yeah, the undersuit's different. It's not black. It's not a bad and black. It's Incubi Darkness. And yeah, I like the blue hair. It's very striking, very vibrant. And initially I was going down the route of Escher and just doing lots of different hair tones. In the end, I settled on pink. I quite like that. I was like, actually, you know, just like this off pink that goes up to white almost. I did it on one witch, really liked it, did it on two. And I was like, yeah, that's quite cool. Did it on a unit. I was like, nah, I'm sold on it. I'm going to keep just doing this pink vibrant hair. I quite like that. All the unit types, including like the little top knots that come out the back of the helmets and stuff. But yes, it was inspired by, but some modifications that I now, from experience, went, I'm going to do this a bit different because I like this colour and I like that colour. So yeah, absolutely.
It's fun when you get into really enjoying painting and highlighting a particular set of colours and just looking for opportunities to do that more on more miniatures that you're enjoying painting. It's very rewarding.
In fact, as an evolution of painting that original collection, so I edge highlighted all the raiders for the original Court of Red Grief, and it took, I mean, I had four raiders and a ravager to paint, and it was a good week or two of like edge highlighting, doing the crew and stuff, and that was fun. I enjoyed it, but my experience on that was, if I just like spray the whole model silver, put some washes on it, put some brasses on it, and then pick out panels that I want, like Incubi Darkness here, corn red there, and then dry brush silver again, and then just do little scratches. I did that on one test, which at the time I think was a raider because that was the only vehicle I'd built. Even though now from experience would go, I'd do it on a Reaver. So absolutely lesson learned there. But yeah, absolutely. I found doing the metallic, like chipping on the edges instead of just, again, flat color with chipping on the edges, it looks fine. You don't have to sit there doing all these tedious like blends and recess washes and edge highlights. It's just like, no, it looks like it's a big honking space knife that flies around and it stabs stuff, and people ride it and then jump off and stab them with their own small little knives. So yeah, absolutely, it felt more of a tool than a transport, and that tool from time to time will get scratched up and damaged because it does look quite sharp.
So this is the circle of the bloodied blade, which is the Crusade army that we see in the new codex. And it is very witch cult heavy, but it is led by Archon Piach the Cruel. Where do you get your inspiration for your names from?
I don't know. I mean, well, there's two leaders in the army. There is a succubus as well, which is named after Mrs. Peach, but I can't for the life of me. It's probably something like Lizith. Hesperix, something like that, because it's the Lilith Hesperix model. But yeah, so I have to introduce myself into every game because it makes it more precious that he doesn't die, because it's me. You know, I've got to make sure I'm there and surviving and doing all the stuff. But yeah, the background's kind of like toying with the idea that he's a bit of a failed Archon, and now he's just allying himself with some witches in the arena. And yeah, it's the typical kind of relationships that you get with Drukhari. He's going to get backstabbed, but he's got a couple of loyal retainers around him, like his Larmian, his Urgul, and his Slith. Again, now with all the new stuff that's come out, so we've got like new Incubi, we've got Drazar. I want to do a new version of a Piach the Cruel and use Drazar as the base and use the rules as Drazar and just give him a bold head with a top knot and make him look like me. So that'll be his new arena version. So he's there in the full fight, because that's the point of my armies as well, the Crusade army. It's a lot of things go on real space raids. These are entertainers for Kamara. They tend to spend most of their time on the sands of the Colosseum, butchering and murdering stuff for their own pleasure as well as the crowd's pleasure. So I've based them quite heavily with lots of sand and debris and pools of blood. So I've got like loads of ideas of things of where I want to go. So I don't want to introduce some new incubi, because my previous incubi were the resin ones. And I used the dome heads again on those from the Reavers, which just looks cool. So these domed glass helms. So I might do the same thing with them again, just bring them back out and just, you know, paint up a new five. Then I've got like loads and loads of Melusai. So I want to do like more Slith using the Melusai models, give them extra arms, give them more shredders. I think it's shredders, no, shard carbines, that's what they have. And then even things you got like all the Daughters of Cain stuff. I did a little diorama for the Gathering Storm books, and it was for the second one, which was the Fracture of Beel Tan. And it was just a little thing that came through, an email popped from, I think it was Lisa Ward, and she was just like, if you're up for doing a diorama, we can just, you know, help you out. We like get some bits and like a base to put it on, but we're looking at like picking a scene from one of the books. And I remember reading through the Fracture of Beel Tan and going, this is really cool, because it's where Yvraine is in the arena before she becomes, you know, Yvrain of the Yanari. She's there fighting away. There's lots of things, lots of different things happening. At one point, she's fighting against some crone of Morakai. Then she's fighting against Lilith Hesperex. She's fighting, I think, some form of Tyranid. And then there's a whole bunch of incubi that are there as well, just trying to assassinate her. And it's at that point, just before she gets killed and reborn, the Vizark appears behind these incubi and starts slicing the heads off them. So I did the diorama from that point of view, where it's like the last charge of her with her blood brides. But for artistic license, I put the Vizark next to her because it looked a bit weird that he's behind. And I couldn't quite pose him at the time to get a decent pose. I was a bit rushed to get it done in time. So I was like, yeah, artistic license, sticking next to it. It's that scene where the incubi have turned up to try and murder her, and he's there helping out, and I've got some blood brides, which I use the witches from the Daughters of Cain to make some blood brides. They're great models, giving them Drukhari arms. Just fits perfectly. So they've got like their little van braces with like the sigils on it, the serrated armor. Give them like, it was the full Sister of Slaughterhead with like the little spike crest that goes on the top, and then I just used a bit of masking tape to make like little veils and trails coming out the back of the helmets. Blood brides, they've got to have like veils and trails if they've got the word bride in it, right? So sure. It's written, you know, this stuff writes itself, Wade. So I did a couple of those, one being stabbed by an incubi, one like going in for a kill but at the same time might just get killed. So it's like quite a dynamic scene. And I used, I think, a bit of Daughter of Cain on the lower legs of Yvrain as well, because she's still a pit fighter at this point. So yeah, there was that was a fun project. But yeah, really delving into like all these different conversions you can do and the things you've got. And I've got a whole list of a menagerie of beasts. There's so many cool beasts of the Mortal Realms that I just think, you know, I'll make something and have like a beastmaster with like all these things he'll let loose. Like, oh, I've got Fenrisian hounds that are all red. Let's unleash them. I've got like a giant Bastillodon. I'll just give that a weird sort of different head and put more spikes on it, and come up with a name that's not Bastillodon, that sounds like it's from the Seraphon collection. I'll find some name, like a mace head or something. I don't know. I've got loads of ideas of things I want to do for that collection. It's going to grow. Now, that I've not actually had a chance to play any Crusade games at all, and I'm eager to do it. And yeah, seeing like some of the new things you can do with the Drukhari, especially, I just love the idea of, I did a unit of Blood Brides a long, long time back in that collection that I don't think they're in the actual photography of the codex, but I use Kabbalite warrior legs and bodies, so a bit more heavily armored, not something you'd normally expect for witches, but it kind of gave that visual, they look a bit more elite. And I again use masking tape on like the spears, and I give most of them spears, and they all like masking tape and like pennants coming off them, so they looked a little bit more elite looking, kind of close to incubi almost. But I use them as a unit of Blood Brides, and yeah, you can have them back. Hecatrix Blood Brides, and it's so good, you get three attacks instead of one. I'm a big fan of Blood Brides, and yeah, getting your Trueborn back as well.
Is there David nothing you can't do with masking tape? That's my initial thought after hearing this.
Yeah, you can use it for everything. I want to do some cool trails coming off, like the Raiders as well. After doing my conversion for Slaanesh, my war shrine, where I incorporated bits of cauldron of blood on it, it's now occurred to me that actually I have big burning braziers on the side. I was like, yeah, you know what? I could do like a big succubus's battle barge. Or maybe PH the Cruel's war barge, and yeah, that would be good. Lots of like daggers and knives and stuff, and severed heads of ultramarines, flesh tearers, and even Argent Shroud maybe.
Well, yeah, if you come out on any real space raids, I would be delighted to meet you with my crusading flesh tearers force. We can put various proclivities to the test on the battlefield to be a good time. Yeah. One of the features that I was a big fan of in this new Drukhari Codex, the kind of post-battle sequence of the territory building in Kamora that you get to do it on.
Yeah.
We do love us a bit of a post-battle sequence and being able to roll on territory tables, and that kind of role-playing aspect of, well, I've got to either conduct myself in the arena, which what your army might be doing, or conduct myself in the real space raids, and then build up those raid points to start building up the little empire back in Kamora. That's excellent.
Some of the names of locations as well, great. I was just having a bit of a read of it but just beforehand. I was just like, this is just gold if I wanted to do like a little campaign based in Kamara. And this was something we were talking before we went, we started recording. I'm like, maybe we should do a kill team each. and like do it as like, you know, in the streets of Kamara, very Necromunda-esque. And I know you've got some cool observations of stuff you've seen in the Twitter sphere of like cool things like that. So yeah, I'm all eager for that. That sounds like good fun. Thanks.
There was a wonderful narrative kill team campaign being run by War Boss Kurgan on Twitter. Shout out to Saul. It was hashtag Shadows of Kamara a couple of years back, and there was loads of Kamarite scenery made, but it was very much that ambition of Necromunda, but in Kamara, and street level fighters, all the kind of infantry stuff that you get in kill team. I was just having to flick through the kill team manuals, and the kill team core manual gives you the option for a Kabbalite warrior or a witch. Got those data sheets in there and all the different specialisms that are available to those two data sheets, and there's quite a lot of narrative storytelling potential that you could do even with just those two basic data sheets. And the Elites supplement adds in the Racks and the Incubi and the Mandrakes. I was going to ask about those sort of mercenary elements when you, before we get into kill teams, because we surely will, when you're working on a larger collection, things like the Incubi or the Scourges or Mandrakes, how do you treat those kind of mercenary units that aren't necessarily aligned with the sub-faction that you've painted in the same colours?
Personally, I always do them different. I for my Red Grief collection, my personal collection, I've done my Incubi in like a Warblock bronze armor. I think it's still got the same undersuit, so I've kept the undersuit there. So I'm using like the Incubi Darkness again, and I think I might have flashes of red here and there, but a lot of it is very different to the rest of the collection. Same for the Mandrakes. I did those with jet black skin, white hair, glowing effects on them. And the way that I painted those weapons are different as well. It's a nice opportunity to do something a bit different. They're based the same, so that kind of ties them in. There's some elements in there, like, yeah, that little bit of banding or like leather work is the same tone as everything across here. So you've got some things that link it together, but certainly getting the opportunity to just do like different color schemes. I think if I did Scourge, I might actually tie them in with the rest of the collection, because I quite like just tying that in. But, or maybe not, maybe just go a complete different route and make them very, very different. I did use some Scourge parts to make a different Archon or Succubus, and it was to lead a unit of witches. It was like 15 of them I ended up making, and I did that character. It was almost like the Colonel Schaefer, Colonel Schaefer's Last Chances of the Drukhari, and it was like some failed Archon that's now like leading this band of like different races of folks from the galaxy, and I count them all as witches and like as a succubus. And then that was all in bone armor. I really liked that. I was like, oh yeah, because it had the Scourge kind of, a lot of Scourge elements to it, like the Scourge helm, that kind of beaked helm, and I painted it all in bone armor. I really liked that kind of look to it. I was like, I should probably do a unit in bone armor, that looks cool. But yeah, doing that, yeah, that unit of witches, which is like a handful of space marines, a few guardsmen. Some of them were based off collections that we did for the army painting team as well. So there's like a Latok, no, it's an Iandan, Storm Guardian, who's got like the tiger stripe markings on its helm. And then there's like some of the Cadians that we did for the Cadian 92nd collection. So there's like an eventually noble as well. He's got to be in there. But yeah, it was just a bit of fun. Just like, yeah, it's just a bunch of gladiators that have survived this long, and they're entertaining to the crowd. So yeah, just treat them as a unit of witches. Why not? There's another way of getting some of the colours in the army.
Yeah. I was just thinking of the Orak collection, your Orak unit that's in your circle of the Blade collection. That's a nice expression of how a unit can stand out and they're not tied into the same colors. And those bone faceplates, again, a really nice distinctive feature of that unique unit, the outlier in the wider collection. Bone helps stuff stand out if there's not a lot of bone elsewhere in the collection. That's where I get from you.
Yeah, I think I did the Venom for them as well in bone tones with like red markings. And when I was talking to Stu, and I think it was, yeah, it was just talking to Stu, like, you know, oh, can we use your collection in the book? I was like, yes, please. Yeah, by all means, take it. Yeah. And he was like, oh, you know, why are the Racks there then? You know, what's the story behind those? I was like, oh, they're just working with the witches because they patch them back up, because that's what they do. They keep that big Imperial Knight alive when a witch has been like had half a face ripped off. You know, if the money's there, they'll stitch it back on and make her feel a little bit better. So yeah, having the Racks in there is like almost the medical team, but in a very dark and twisted way. And also to experiment upon the humans that they get and all the other things, and like making more stimmed up or like, try their new sort of special cocktails. Like, yeah, while they're not looking, just inject them with that growth serum. Yeah, let's see what happens when that goes, when they go out to the arena. Oh, ooh, no, we won't do that again. So, yeah, that's why they're there.
So right. Have you got any other notions for things that you might convert or kitbash or add to this army or any other Drukhari collections based on things that you worked on recently or been released recently?
So with Kill Team, I'd definitely like to do some Kabbalite stuff. A bit of me is thinking of introducing a cabal, whether that's a different colour entirely or try and tie it in, because there's some nice models in the Kabbalite section of the Drukhari. Obviously, the Incubi I mentioned earlier. I think more witches at some point, because that army is quite a few years old now. So it would be nice to either just start from scratch and do another witch cult, or do just something entirely different, or just keep building upon it. But I'm definitely in the vein of the skirmish realm at the moment in my mind. So doing huge collections is not something that I'm, especially with the time permitting of having a little one running around. So this idea of maybe doing a kill team based as if like, or even using Necromunda rules and stuff like that, I definitely think I might do a couple of different, maybe a witch cult kill team, maybe a Kabbalite kill team. And then some other stuff in between that. So there's definitely things on the cards I like to do. I do have a set of Incubi, so I want to get them painted, and I might just tie them in with the current collection. But after that, I just don't know. Wait, there's so many things I want to do. And the amount of kits that we have available, because we've got Kronoses, Taloses, it's just too much. Too much cool stuff to do, not enough time. And I'm not going to get away from this meeting now and start like looking at all my kits in my box going, oh yeah, I could do that. Oh yeah, I should do that. Because I've got loads of Darkling Caven things. I've got loads of Daughters of Cain things. Oh, of course I want to do the Slith, don't I? Oh, yeah.
To do a little Drukhari kill team. I think I do like the notion of kit mashing bits from the Daughters of Cain range with the Drukhari range. Just there's quite a lot of dynamism, certainly in the more recent sculpts, and the idea of using some of those Malusai to make Slith, other mercenaries, other beasts. There's a lot of like cool kit mashing potential, and the opportunity to maybe do something narratively kill teamly set in one of the darker reaches of Kamora that doesn't often get a bit of light. We can just make up weird stuff and play some kill team games, because you've got a bit of a Kabbalite proclivity at the moment. It sounds like you've scratched a lot of witch itches. I'm looking to scratch a witch itch, and I know that Nick has been stitching together a wonderful homunculus coven flavored. So maybe we could get some of the major factions of Kamora represented at some point in the future. So yeah, I'm definitely going to check out hashtag Shadows of Kamora again for inspiration, because that has been biding background inspiration for that sort of thing. The idea of Gangs of Kamora, which was a, I don't want to put that in inverted commas, Gangs of Kamora was a board game. You've referenced it earlier. You kind of consulted on the lovely color schemes of the bright red and yellow Hellions and Reavers that we saw on the front of that box, and duking it out, very distinctive, very visually attractive and eye-catching. But Gangs of Kamora just strikes me as a great name for a kill team narrative campaign as well. On the shelves anymore to cause confusion. So maybe one day.
Well, I'm just thinking now, maybe I focus a lot of my efforts on making some cool scenery that makes it feel very, you know, Kamora themed. Like I've spent time like doing like Daughters of Cain, temples and Necromunda based stuff. Like maybe I could go down the route of doing some Kamorite like veined scenery. That'll probably be a lot of plastic card cut to like jagged shapes around existing scenery sets. Oh, well, good look at that, see what I can come up with.
I've mentioned this before on Warhammer Live, I think, but in the era when White Dwarf used to tell people what local gaming events were on in different Games Workshop stores in their country, and they used to be kind of tongue-in-cheek punny names for some of the events and battles, one of my favorite ones from towards the end of the 90s, I think, was Kamora Never Dies. So maybe we can use Kamora Never Dies as the name, because, you know, it's at all destructions or chaos invasions. That's an intersection of your interests, isn't it? You like that.
They could go on the day after Kamora.
We do like introducing that sort of naming convention to our games, so we'll have to see. It's also worth shouting out the hobbyist by the name of @SkySerpent40K on Instagram, who I know we featured some of their lovely collection of Drukhari on hashtag Warhammer Community Hobby Roundup Show. And in particular, there was a unit of Hellions that we featured most recently at the point of recording this, I think, that had helmets from across the wider Drukhari range to suggest that these high-speed street punks of the skies were nipping through Kamora with their glaives, taking the heads off various members of maybe nobility or just other members of Kamorite society, and taking their trophy helmets and whooping off, which I thought was a great way of adding competitive narrative, and when you've been talking about ways to make those sorts of units stand out from the wider cult, because they are kind of like street punks and street gangs, and that's a great way of showing their proclivities. And there's a hashtag Road to Camorra I saw Sky Serpent 40k posting recently, but there's loads of great Drukhari conversions in the RPG, so you should definitely have Warcry Warbands worked into Drukhari things. I know you'd painted one of the Grimwatch, and we'd be looking at that going, painted with dark skin and white hair, doesn't it look an awful lot?
Yeah,
and start making some mandrakes out of this.
Well, I was looking at the Sylvaneth range, so the things like the tree revenants and stuff, using that hair on things like, because I've got the Grimwatch, I've got the set the other day for the Grimwatch, and I've got a load of the because if I do Spite Revenants, then I've got all that wispy hair, which I can then stick onto onto the Grimwatch and make like some horrible looking mandrakes. But the other thing I was thinking about, it just occurred to me while you were talking about like conversion and stuff, is there's a lot of cool new characters that are out that could easily fall into like new archons and nobility. So look at the Gene City called Magos. That would make a great Drukhari commander.
It would, yeah.
I don't know. Obviously, the conversion's already out there. I've seen all sorts of conversions with that model. The good old Darkling Coven Sorceress, again, makes. I've used that on top of my Razor. I don't know if you see it in the Crusade section.
Yes.
It's treating it like a chariot. Riding
not a raider, is it? Riding the
Razorwing
Jet Fighter into battle. That is sensory input and a half. Yeah, that is a thrill seeker right there.
Yeah. She's got a knife. She's got a knife as well, just in case things get too close.
It's closer so I can stab them with my knife will be the new meme. Excellent.
But yeah, there's lots of cool kits now for converting. And, you know, stuff that you won't normally think about that would be like, maybe I could use a shard speaker, slashy shard speaker. They got quite jaggedy armor. Maybe I could use the new Lord of Pain. He's quite bulky, but maybe I have a bulked up looking Archon who's like had a few stims from the Homunculus Covens. Just give him some knife ears, it'd be fine.
Could maybe do a bulked up Homunculus, one who's decided maybe with access to the masterworks of flesh crafting available, maybe I could look more than just sticks. Maybe these grotesques and racks have got something like you could do with a still wizened little evil sorcerer scientist head on top of a grotesquely distended body like the Lord of Pain's got.
Yeah, I was actually looking at, although I've got Incubi, the Myrmidesh Painbringers would make interesting looking Incubi as well. Mate, I know they've got shields, so I might have to look at like how I incorporate glaives and stuff. But yeah, that nice armor, sleek armor. Again, Slaanesh was born from the fall, and these guys were kind of a little bit dark before the fall. So it kind of ties in quite nicely that they have like maybe similar armor to that kind of vein. They'll just file off any Slaanesh symbols of pauldrons and swords and stuff. But yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff that we can use now to make cool conversions.
It's a nice unspoken link to Slaanesh, because the Drukhari are the ones who kind of, you know, the Eldari broke things. And then the craft world is trying to make amends and living humble, respectful lives and trying not to make sure anything bad happens again. And the Harlequins are telling the tales to make sure history doesn't repeat itself. But the Drukhari just ran away. Like, oh, made Slaanesh. We'll just leave that for you to sort out. We'll just disappear into a sub-reality. It'd be fine. Just let it all blow over. So, yeah.
Carry on. That's nice.
Well, that is plenty of fine information, I hope, for anyone inspired to do some Drukhari converting or kit bashing or building. Hopefully there's stuff in there to cover the principles of army painting, planning out what you'd like to get onto different miniatures and different combinations, and introducing some of those different elements, the sub-factions, even beyond the sub-factions of the Drukhari, adding in some of those mercenary elements like the Mandrakes, the Incubi. The Scourges, etc. Loads of fine ideas. I think we're planning to talk to Nick Baton about his own Drukhari collection at some point in the future to get another take on doing this sort of good stuff. And yeah, very much inspired to put a kill team together myself. So thank you as always for your time and your insights, Peachy.
You're most welcome. Thank you for having me, as always.
Always a pleasure, never a chore. And thank you everyone who's tuned in for this episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. We will see you again very soon.